Hello and welcome back on Root Access Berlin. I'm here today with Nacho Coloma, the CTO of Koliseo.
Koliseo is a startup that aims to make ticketing a pleasant experience as simple as possible.
So let us see a demo. I'm here on the Koliseo website. The nice thing is that you have implemented sign-ins with all possible accounts. So I will sign in with my Google account. And now I want to create an event. So the factory will be opening its doors for the first time in a couple of days. And I want to invite people to the factory opening. In the next steps, I can define the details of my event. I can also then create tickets, and you have a platform for handling all the flow, including registrations on the venue itself.
That's it. You can control how the tickets are sold, you can set the prices, and you can also control the access. When the day comes, you can go in the entrance of the event, and with your Android device, you can just check out the tickets.
All right. So now tell me, Nacho, why did you choose to first App Engine, and then also you chose to use a NoSQL database, the App Engine data store, even if you admitted that you had a mostly SQL background before?
That's right. We come from a company with a lot of SQL experience, but for us, when we were developing this project, we wanted something that could scale and that had a... we wanted all the uptime, but not the headaches. We didn't want to be answering calls from our customers all day long. So we wanted to try something new.
And so, yes, this is something I hear a lot from startups, that they go with NoSQL because it's fashionable. Here I would like to hear your expert opinion and help people decide rationally between SQL and NoSQL. So maybe we can try to come up with a list of of checks that you can do against your project requirements to help people decide. So the first thing to consider is, of course, scalability. Can you tell us more about that?
When you're talking about scalability in the SQL world, the things are more already thought out, and the thing is, you're going to have, let's say, one server. Now, your server is going to be scaling, and at some point, you will have to put different servers as well. And you have to decide if you want to do vertical sharding or horizontal sharding. You have to decide if you're going to go with master and replicas. When you want to make your database scale, you have to learn, you have to read a lot. You have to read about the last 20 years of SQL databases, differentiate the best practices from things that are more or less outdated or something. With NoSQL, the thing is, you don't have this. You have a data store that is going to work from the beginning and is going to scale for as many servers as you like automatically. Yes, you also have a learning curve, but it's much shorter, it's more focused on what matters.
So actually, the App Engine data store, which is one example of a NoSQL database, what you say is that it's multi-server from the start.
Yeah.
And it basically hides from you all the multi-server complexity that is powering it.
High availability, load balance, distribution of your data, everything is taken care of automatically. You don't have to think about that. You don't have to configure that. It just works.
The second point that I hear a lot from people is that their feeling is that NoSQL represents their data in a more natural way. Was that the case also for Koliseo?
When you are talking about SQL databases, you have standard solutions to standard problems. So you are always watching your problems with the same lenses. Let's say, for example, that you are talking about a user account. You have your user account, and as you have seen, you can have multiple OAuth providers, so multiple credentials. How do you do that with a SQL database?
So we tried to represent this on the slide here, and I think you need two tables, right?
Yes, right. You need a master detail tables, and what you're going to do is have a table with all your users and another one with all your OAuth IDs. And you're going to relate one another. With NoSQL, it doesn't have to be that way. You have you have other options. You have multi-valued fields. With multi-valued fields, the same user can have multiple values for the same field. And you can handle that as if it was a single value. So the same way you would have a user with a single OAuth ID, for the same price, you can have multiple values. And you don't need a separate table for that.
So for instance, here my first user, Bill K, has two accounts with which he can log in onto Coliseo. And that means that any time I want to return a user that has a given OAuth ID, in SQL, I have to do a join. But also, whenever you want to retrieve users by any criteria, let's say I want all my senior users, like here, birth year less than 1950, then the Bill K will come up twice in the results.
Yes, right.
Because the join actually created two Bill K's, one Bill K that has a Google provider and one Bill K that had a Facebook provider. So now when I handle those users, I have to handle those duplicates.
Yeah, that's a common problem.
And what I hear from people on a philosophical level is that they like the fact that in a NoSQL database, a user entity is one entity. It has its identity, it has its key, and you know exactly where your user is.
Yeah, and it's conceptually simpler because you have a single entity with multiple values for the OAuth IDs, but you don't have to mix entities just because of the data store you're using. In that sense, it's much simpler.
So a brief introduction about the code snippets that we will be seeing during this episode. When making Coliseo, you also made SimpleDS, which is an access layer for the App Engine database that allows you, correct me if I'm wrong, that allows you to represent your database entities using Java objects.
Yeah, that's right. You can get all the mapping between Java and the data store entities, and you can match and mix between, and you can use also JSON representation or nested objects. It takes care of all of that. It's a little bit like Objectify. You also have that in the Java world. It came out more or less at the same time as SimpleDS.
So on scalability, NoSQL wins. On the way of representing data, the philosophical argument is that NoSQL kind of wins, although you can argue both ways. And now the engineers designing NoSQL databases also had to sacrifice some things. So let's talk about that. And first of all, maybe what is really super nice about SQL databases is that they have the SQL language. Anything I write that is syntactically correct will execute, maybe slowly, maybe using all of my memory, but it will execute. It will return results.
Yeah, I miss that a lot. You don't have that in NoSQL. Some of the queries that you can imagine won't execute because you are using incompatible ways of querying the data store. For example, you cannot query values different than two, for example.
But even before that, if you want to query by equality, value equals something, you need an index on that value.
Yeah. Yeah, you need, if you're going to launch a query, you need an index for everything that is inside that query. For example, if you're querying for a single value, then you need an index for that value. If you need two values in the same query, then you need a composite index for these two values. Also, if you are sorting by a value, querying by another value, you need a composite index for that too. And that's sometimes a problem because every time you're inserting the values and also each index that you are adding. So sometimes it's more the effort of writing the indexes than it is writing actual data.
Yes, and also based on the queries that you want to run, you have to organize your data in specific ways when you use a NoSQL database.
Yeah, sometimes you have to plan in advance, how am I going to query this data? Because you can, before you can design it. So how am I going to organize my entities? Which indexes am I going to use? Sometimes you have to organize your data to be able to execute this other way of querying the information, this feature or whatever. You need to do that, but that's also common with SQL databases. At some point, you're also refactoring, so it's no news for any of us.
But that is where database schemas come in SQL databases. When I want to add a new field, I do one command, which is alter table, and I have a new column in my table. If you want to do this in a NoSQL database, it's slightly more complicated.
Yeah. If you want to modify your existing data in NoSQL databases, you have to iterate over all the existing records, adding new fields, removing existing fields, whatever, to get what you would do with a single command with SQL databases. That would be alter table, and it's already magically there.
And also, if I have a large project based on SQL, usually I have a database administrator who is the guardian of my schema, and he locks it down to prevent random rogue engineers from adding random rogue fields wherever they see that they would like to have them.
Yeah, you wouldn't have that in NoSQL. For example, you wouldn't have referential integrity. So I can modify data by hand and leave the data store in an inconsistent state. That can happen. You are not forced to have the same structure in all your entities at all. And sometimes that's good because, for example, you have a data that depends on the kind that is it has. I have one field, or I don't have this field, I have a different field. You can use that to your advantage. Or you can just use, in our case, in Java, you have your persistent classes, and that defines the properties that you have. You can use it or not as you like.
So that would be another win for SQL, the presence of database schemas. And the last point that I would like us to discuss is coherency. NoSQL being multi-server by default, that is probably where the trade-offs are the strongest. Let's distinguish two different types of coherency. First, the coherency of transactions. On a transaction, you want to be ACID. Mm-hmm. And you always want to be ACID. There is no trade-off there. But to run a transaction on a NoSQL database, you have to do something special.
Yeah, concretely in the App Engine data store, you have entity groups. Entity groups are based on a parent-child relationship model. So you define your parent, and everything that is hanging from that parent, all of that share the same transaction.
And so you have to put all your entities into one entity group before you can run a transaction on that entity group.
It's more that you make clusters. All the entities in a cluster are going to be part of that transaction. That was originally the only way you had in App Engine to do transactions. Actually, it's more flexible, and now you can make cross-group transactions, XGE transactions, that can put some up to 5 different entity groups in the same transaction.
And also, the fact that you put entities into one transaction group, that severely limits the rate at which you can write to that transaction group, right?
Yep. You have a limited rate of, I think it's something like 1 to 5 writes per second.
So that's very low.
Yeah, actually. And you can create a great contention there. If you have a lot of users trained to push their transactions in the same transaction group, if it's different transaction groups, it's fine. But if it's in the same transaction group, you have a limitation there.
Briefly, I would like to mention a second type of coherency, which is the read your own writes coherency, which in the SQL world, again, is usually exact. Here in the NoSQL world, it can happen that you send a write, and even reads that come after it still see the old value until a certain point in time where the new value will become visible. So it's called eventual consistency.
Yes, that's right.
Was that a problem for you?
Not usually. I mean, it's not usually a problem because we are talking about 1 second of time between I do the change and all the queries in the world are going to see that change. There's always a small gap. Maybe your listing, your user listing is going to be 1 second outdated. That's no big deal.
So it's something you have to know about. But in your opinion, that was actually a good thing, a good constraint to relax.
Yeah.
Let us recap here the 5 points. On scalability, NoSQL wins. I think we all agree on that. On the way you can structure your data,
multiple valued fields is a big win here. And I really don't miss other things. But yeah, as we were talking before, maybe that's a problem for some heavy users, but.
Yes, but on the other hand, SQL is a great language. If you have a DB admin enforcing strong schemas, that is something you will miss in the NoSQL world. And the way you run transactions in NoSQL is also involves slightly more work than in the SQL world.
Yeah.
All right, thank you very much, Nacho. And we will be seeing you again in the next episode. The next episode will have tips and tricks to help you overcome some of those NoSQL limitations so that you can take advantage of the power of NoSQL and still work around the limitations.
Yep, that will be fun.
So we'll see you next time. Thank you very much, Nacho, for being with us.
Thanks.
Thank you for watching Root Access Berlin. Goodbye.
Bye.